Despite the fact that the Chinese were the first to tinker with rockets 1,000 years ago, although for purposes certainly not peaceful, in the most recent space race, China has decided to get involved only in 1970, a bit out of time when the first men were already walking on the moon and the two superpowers, the USA and the USSR, seemed to have taken an unbridgeable advantage. In that year, the Chinese launched their first satellite. After that, everything seemed to stop again, until the end of the century, when globalization and political renewal led the Chinese government to make space exploration a strategic cornerstone of its international policy. Suffice it to say that in 2020, China spent about $11 billion on space, making it the second economic power in the sector after the US, $22 billion budget, ranking in which they have far surpassed Europe, 7.5, Russia, 2.5, India, 1.9, and Japan, 1.7. This commitment led to the first orbital flight of a taikonaut in 2003, which was followed in 2011 by the launch of a space station to which two different missions with three-man crews docked. Then there was the assault on the moon, with the first-ever descent of a rover on the hidden side of the satellite, and the mission to bring home lunar samples, a majestic crescendo which is being followed by the current attempt to drop a rover on Mars as well. Will it succeed? The Questions to the Sky, Tianwen in Chinese, is the name of a text attributed to the poet Tianwen, who lived between the 4th and 3rd centuries BC, a work that takes the form of a series of questions in verse with which the author questions some fundamental philosophical and scientific issues. Evidently, now China hopes to find the answer to some of these questions, considering that the space probe currently traveling to Mars was given the name Tianwen 1. A name that, according to the Chinese Space Agency, will be given to all of China's planetary exploration missions, signifying the Chinese nation's perseverance in pursuing truth and science and exploring nature and the universe. In fact, the mission, whose launch took place in the early hours of July 23rd from the Wenchang Space Center, is particularly ambitious. If all goes well, in fact, for the first time in the history of Martian exploration, a single spacecraft will bring to the Red Planet an orbiter, a lander, and a rover, with a scientific load of 13 instruments. 7 mounted on board the spacecraft that will enter in orbit around the planet, and 6 on board the rover that will be released shortly after the landing module will rest on the Martian soil. Thus, the China National Space Administration, after being the first to place a probe on the hidden hemisphere of the moon, also aspires to be the first to successfully complete a mission of this type, after the failure of the only other mission that attempted to bring orbiters, landers, and rovers to Mars, the Soviet Mars 3 back in 1971. In fact, China had already tried in 2011 to bring a probe around the Red Planet, but the orbiter Yingwo 1 was involved in the failure of the Russian mission Phobos Grunt, that once reached the Earth orbit, then failed to find the thrust to enter the trajectory to Mars. Now China is trying again, and the objectives of this new triple mission are very clear: to study the morphology and geological structure of Mars, as well as its evolution and its causes. To do this, the probe will analyze the topography of the planet, paying particular attention to features such as dry riverbeds, volcano reliefs, wind erosion, glaciers at the poles, etc. And to this purpose are dedicated the 2 cameras on the orbiter. They will then study the characteristics of the surface and underground layers of the soil of Mars, as well as the distribution of water ice. This is the task assigned to the georadars present on the orbiter and the rover. They will analyze the composition and type of rocks present on the surface, as well as the carbonate materials present in the ancient lakes, rivers, and other environments conditioned by the past presence of water on the planet. For this, there are spectrometers on board the orbiter and the rover, as well as the multispectral camera. It will also follow the ionosphere, climate, seasons, and more generally, the atmosphere of Mars. This is the role of the 2 particle detectors on the orbiter and the rover's weather station. And finally, the internal structure of Mars, its magnetic field, the history of its geological evolution, the internal distribution of its mass and gravitational field will be investigated. Magnetometers as well as radars present on the orbiter and rover are dedicated to this objective. To collect all this data, the orbiter module and the rover have on board several cameras and various resolutions, the highest of 2048 by 2048 pixels, and for several bands of the electromagnetic spectrum. A georadar to probe the Martian subsurface up to 100 meters deep, particle analyzers, mass spectrometers, magnetic field detectors, and magnetometers. The orbiter, in addition to collecting data, will also act as a bridge for communications between the rover and Earth. Once at its destination, presumably around February 11, 2021, Tianwen 1 will eventually settle into a very eccentric polar orbit, which will take it 265 kilometers from the surface at its closest point to 12,000 kilometers at its farthest. The lander-rover pair, on the other hand, will have to wait until perhaps April 24th before it can undock from the orbiter and face its descent to the Martian surface. This calculated wait, already used for the American Viking landers in the 1970s, will allow to carefully study the conditions of the Martian atmosphere before attempting the dangerous descent. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell. You will help us to make products of even higher quality. To have it touch the ground without any problems, the lander has even been equipped with three braking systems that will be activated in succession. A parachute, the thrust of the retro rockets, and finally the shock absorbers of the support feet. Some of the technologies required for this type of operation have been adapted from those used by China in previous lunar missions. In particular, the lander's automatic guidance control and navigation system is developed from that of the Chang'e 4. This mission successfully landed a rover on the hidden side of the moon last year. Since the Martian surface can be rough and include many rocks that would endanger the mission, the landing system uses a radar and a camera that compare the images taken during the descent with those of an internal database. The importance of this system lies in the fact that during the descent phase towards the Martian soil, it is impossible to intervene manually to control the descent of the lander. This fact is due to the enormous distance between Earth and Mars at the time of the operation, equal to almost 300 million kilometers, from which follows a delay in communication, and therefore the execution of any correction commands in the order of 16 minutes, a time completely incompatible with the duration of the descent, which will be completed in no more than 5 minutes. But even with the assistance of the automatic guidance system used on the Moon, the operation will certainly not be risk-free. Mars' gravity is more than twice that of the Moon, and unlike the Moon, the planet also has an atmosphere that, although tenuous, has an important role in the attitude of a probe landing. However, it must be said that the possibility of choosing the best time for the descent and the fact of starting it from a known point of the orbit followed at that time by Tianwen 1 brings considerable advantages over those missions that choose to descend to the surface coming directly from outer space without passing through an orbital phase. And this is the case of the Perseverance rover, which will descend on the edge of the Jezero crater, 1 week after the entry into orbit of the Chinese spacecraft. If all goes well, the lander of the Tianwen 1 mission will rest in Utopia Planitia, which in English means Plain of Utopia, a vast flat region in the northern hemisphere of Mars. With a diameter of 3,300 kilometers, it is in fact one of the largest impact basins in the solar system, flat with no large craters or orographic obstacles of any significance. This area is thought to have been filled with water and therefore may contain extremely interesting study elements. Photographed from space, this region has always shown strange features such as polygonal cracks and pits, all details that on Earth are associated with the presence of subsurface ice or permafrost. So planetologists began to suspect that an icy deposit was also hiding on Mars. And in fact, in 2016, thanks to information collected by the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter mission, the U.S. Space Agency announced that it had discovered a large amount of water in the subsurface in the form of ice at a depth of just a dozen meters. The peculiarity and the scientific interest of the region is undoubtedly due to the fact that the most probable landing point of the Chinese lander is located practically halfway between the landing site of Perseverance and the one where Viking 2 landed on September 3, 1976. In any case, once landed without damage, The Chinese lander will release a six-wheeled rover powered by solar panels, very similar in architecture to the lunar predecessors U-2 and U-22, and also to NASA rover Spirit and Opportunity. Unlike the latter, however, it does not have a robotic arm that allows the positioning of instruments in contact with rocks or the ground. From that moment, the rover will leave for an exploration of the surface that will last about 90 Martian days, equivalent to almost 93 Earth days. Weighing 240 kilograms, the Chinese rover measures 200 centimeters in length, 300 in width, and 185 in height. A mast supports the two navigation cameras and the multispectral camera. To move around, it has six independent 30-centimeter diameter wheels arranged on an active suspension system, each with an individual motor and all with an additional motor acting on the steering, which allows the rover to turn on itself and move sideways. Due to the delay in telecommunications with Earth, which can be up to 22 minutes, the rover uses an autonomous navigation system. It has a maximum speed of 200 meters per hour and a navigation speed of 40 meters per hour. It can overcome obstacles 30 centimeters high and overcome slopes with an inclination of 30 degrees. Note that the rover does not yet have its own name. It will, in fact, be assigned one by the end of February, following an international competition. On January 2nd, 163 days after its launch, Tianwen 1 was still on its way to Mars, about 130 million kilometers from Earth. The distance traveled was more than 400 million kilometers after a sequence of orbital maneuvers was performed as it moved away from Earth orbit and approached the red planet. So far, Tianwen 1 has performed three orbital corrections and equipment checks, according to the space agency. The probe remained in good condition as it continued its journey to Mars, still 8.3 million kilometers away. On February 11th, when Tianwen 1 is within 9,000 kilometers of the Martian surface, the main engine will be turned on for 14 minutes to slow the probe down and place it in a very elliptical orbit of 400 by 180,000 kilometers with an 11-day period. The probe will then perform a series of maneuvers to enter the final orbit, from where, for a couple of months, it will try to precisely locate the landing site and complete the necessary preparations for the maneuver of the detachment of the lander. The one developed by the People's Republic of China in the space field is a wide-ranging and long-term strategy. There are many other objectives set by Beijing for the years to come. In addition to Tianwen 1, which is only the first of a long series of missions that will reach the major planets of the solar system, in 2021 the construction of the first Chinese modular station should begin. By 2025, there is a planned shipment into space of a prototype solar power plant. In 2028, the second independent mission to Mars should be launched. And by 2036, China aspires for a first human mission to the moon. Exactly like the space race between the United States and the Soviet Union, the challenge between space programs is anything but purely scientific. Beyond the effects on the prestige that the nations involved obtain from the demonstration of their technical abilities, the development of space technologies has an immediate impact on industry in general, and above all on defense. New models of intercontinental missiles, improved satellite systems for communication, Earth observation, and why not espionage, are just some of the most immediate effects of space development on the military capabilities of a country. It's no coincidence that the United States has hastily created a military branch entirely dedicated to space. The United States Space Force, beyond the science fiction references, was certainly born in part as a response to Beijing's assertiveness in outer space, making Washington strategists feel the urgency to take action. Space has become again a new frontier. It's in the middle of a militarization process destined to continue in the next years. And the clash will see the People's Republic of China among the absolute leaders of the world.